In my capacity, working for the BBC, Alan, I probably get asked more about politics and sport and the relationship of politics and sport than anything else. What's your view of politics and sport, given what has happened to South Africa?
Well, there needs to be a viewpoint that we have separated. And in South Africa, there is a common viewpoint amongst the white administrators. In the 70s, there was a legendary black administrator, Hudson Power, and he quite rightly said, you can't have normal sport in that normal society. What he was saying, that you can't play a game of cricket on a Sunday, in the evening you go to a separate toilet, separate bathroom, so peace. And that was the start of you thinking of South African cricket. In the early 90s, for the very first time in practically, there was unification of South African cricket, where blacks, whites, administrative players, umpires came together for the very first time. And I think certainly from my involvement in first class cricket in 1960, that was the most momentous day in the history of South African cricket when we united. And Richie Benner was one of our guest speakers, and our guest of honour was the one and only Sir Garfield Sobers, and he came from Barbados to be in this very great evening in the history of South African cricket, and even our country. Yeah.
So you would argue actually that sport has a role to play within politics, judging by what's happening in South
Africa. Well, the person who saw the...
Come on, Bushy, sorry, Bushy's back for the gents, everybody. Well done, Bushy, there you go. You wash your hands, Bushy, that's the main thing. Go and sit down.
The person who saw the value of sport as a medium, as a tool to bring white and black South Africans together, is the one and only Nelson Mandela. And, you know, when he was released from Rowan Island, he saw the point of going to all the different games, which were mainly focused on white administrators and sportsmen, to show the country that that is the medium to bring white and black together. And I think it was seen most vividly in 1995, where we had the Rugby World Cup in South Africa, and amongst the Afrikaan in particular, the Springbok emblem meant everything to them. But the Springbok emblem reflected apartheid sport. Only whites could play for it. And to show his appreciation, which he told me subsequently, that why he went out onto the Rugby World Cup final was the Springbok emblem, to show his gratitude to the Afrikaners. He knew how important the emblem was to him, that they supported him as the first ever black president of South Africa.
Council, we don't have any politics in sport in India. We don't.
No, I was going to ask you that. You've stolen my question. Oh, I bet you wish. Something. I bet you wish there weren't.
I mean, there is no politics. There's a lot of sport in politics.
And we've got a dirty politics.
Don't bring Pakistan in, but we're going to say what she is. Well, let's move on to you and ask you a question. I was sitting there, what I can speak to Mike Brearley about, and you must get it every single time. Heavily aged one. Are you fed up with being asked about that remarkable game, or do you kind of just take it on the chin as being, you know, really like a huge part of your life?
Well, Richie says 90% of captaincy is luck, and I think 90% of that was luck, really. Well, timing, luck, 980 runs, the odd catch, the odd decision, the odd this and that, and, you know, it was hugely lucky. And I suppose I'm dining out on it still now. It's very lucky.
But the decisions that you made as captain, were they often completely spur of the moment? Just instant, bang, I'm going to do that. I'm going to bring a bubble on that and change that on. Or was it more of a long-term plan?
I think when you're playing, you have to allow instinct or spontaneity to come in. I mean, and actually you have to throw out some of the plans you had before. But it's a nice balance between planning and doing things by feel and instinct. It's an art, and it's a luck. And sometimes you get it right and sometimes you don't. And often you don't know whether you've got it right or not.
No, until the result happens.
Well, or even the result. might have been better if you'd done the other thing.
Yeah. When you're managing 11 players, when you're on a cricket team, and they're all incredibly diverse, do you have to like each other? Do you have to get on with each other? Do you have to respect each other?
You have to respect each other, but you don't have to like each other. Well, not very much. But actually, most people you do like, at least some of the time.
Yeah.
And you hope they like you occasionally. And
occasionally, or
well, I think it's much easier if there's a strong respect and a warmth. I found it's easier if there's a warmth between you. Sometimes a heat. I mean, sometimes arguments, debates, disagreements. It's like a family. I think a family that argues together in a basically cheerful way is better than a family that never talks.
So, Indian cricket had a very romantic look to it, didn't it? Is that a fair comment when you started with spinners and so on? And your influence, took that series in the West Indies, I mean, you really turned Indian cricket into a much more professional beast. Is that a fair comment?
I think it was a time when Indian cricket was going through a period of turn, in the sense that I think it all started with Tiger Pathori. Tiger Pathori was the first one who showed the Indians that they could be as good as the others. And they didn't need to have an awe about the opposition. And I think from there, other teams have benefited. So I was part of the team which won the series in the West Indies for the first time, and we followed a couple of months later and beat England in England for the first time. So I guess that was probably the turning point as far as belief in being able to win overseas was concerned for Indian cricket.
Yeah. Are you comfortable with where Test cricket is now, particularly with India, the big powerhouse that it is? Is it going to persevere with Test cricket? Is Test cricket safe? Do you think with this enormous influence from the subcontinent of one day cricket itself?
I think the reason why Test cricket is safe is because the players themselves realise that they will be recognised as good players, great players, or ordinary players by what they do at Test level. And if Test performances that are remembered, very few one day performances or very few T20 performances are remembered. It's Test performances that are remembered, and every successful. Every successful limited overs player wants to be a success at the Test level. And I think while that feeling is there amongst the players, I think Test cricket is very safe.
Do you know Bushy? You're watching cricket all the time. In Pakistan, it's very difficult in Pakistan at the moment with no one able to tour there. Is cricket in Pakistan safe for its current problems?
Well, what the swimming said is absolutely right. Test cricket is the ultimate. And every cricketer wants to play that, and we want to play the best cricket in our country. Now, we, at the moment, because of the political situation and insecurity at home, we have to play our home series away from home.
Yes.
And we can accept that. And our youngster, who got potentially good youngster coming up, haven't seen their good players in person. All they watched, good players on the box, television. It's not the same feeling. I think you've got to watch a youngster growing up with potentially good cricket. It's got to be at the ground, get the feel of the atmosphere, get what the crowd is appreciating, get swimming at 100 or something, Tendulkar at 100 or Sunny Tendulkar at 100, and he's seen it and he felt it. That thing we are missing at the moment because of the situation that we know. Unfortunately, like this, but how did it change? For the betterment of cricket and for the betterment of the Pakistan cricket.
Let's hope so. Thanks, Bacher. Last one, Michael. How did you cope as captain? And Ali and all of you can answer this question. The batsman captain. He's someone who they say is always targeted, his form matters, he's the one under pressure, batting for your side, your mind's going a billion miles an hour. Is that a difficult thing to overcome I thought it would or not. I mean, I'll put it down the line.
It was to me, but...
but you're doing yourself down.
No, well, no, I think it's difficult to be a captain of fast team. I mean, Sean Pollock's here, but it is difficult because of the adrenaline that you need to work up to bowl fast. But I think it's a very good thing to be an all-rounder. You understand the bowler's point of view better. Sometimes the bowler said, I didn't understand it at all. And, you know, that's a real point. So yeah. I think it's not easy.
Does it galvanise you? So not to open the bat if captain walking out to play good?
Well, it certainly did. I mean, it's a known fact in cricket over the years, in fact, it's 1877. That, you know, the batsmen are the ones who always have good heads.
Who told you that?
Bowlers are the ones who have the good shoulders. So, when you look at captains, I mean, there are exceptions, of course. But when you look at captains, you'll find most of them have been batsmen.
Very good. I'm very disappointed in you.
What?
I think with Ian Chappell here, surely you would have asked me about that series between Australia and South Africa.
I was going to give you the last word. This is the one man with a 100% record as a Test captain. Ali Bacher played four as captain, won four. Again, Ian Chappell's team won a hell of a hiding, I think is the expression we use. Well, you were in the team. You were captain by then,
eh? I think very briefly, I think they came to South Africa at a disadvantage, to be fair to Ian Chappell on that team. And they first went to
India. Don't be fair to Ian Chappell. Please don't be fair to Ian Chappell. We've not been being fair to Australians.
They went to India, five test matches, and then came to South Africa. And certainly in the previous series against Bobby Simpson's team, the best bowler was Graham McKenzie. He must have picked up a virus there, because first test no wickets, second test no wickets, then drop. The fourth test fence, I think I had about 70. I pulled into the wicket fence, still my wickets. That's the only wicket he got in that series. But in our team, there were two extraordinary attributes. I think firstly, Barry Richards, everybody knows, we only played four test matches. And when I met Sir Donald Bradman for the very first time in 92, he said to me, when I was in Harvard with Barry, he said he was good as Sir Ned Upton and Sir Jack Hobbs. Graham Pollock, well, still 16 test average, one of the greatest of all time. Mike Proctor, 7 test matches, 41 wickets against Australia. He was an unbelievable cricketer. But I think our main value and attribute was that we had four fantastic all-rounders. Eddie Barlow, Tiger Lawrence, Mike Proctor, Trevor Carter. I remember the third test match, in the 70s, I changed the batting order. And at number 8, we had Mike Proctor batting, and number 9, Trevor Carter. And I think that was the strength. The wicketkeepers, first two tests, Dennis Gantley did the bat, and then Dennis Lindsay did the previous series for over 600 runs. So it had enormous depth, and it really was a privilege for me to captain that great team.
Well, what a shame that didn't have the chance to flourish as it should have been. Ali Bacher, Cyril Gavaskar, Mushtaq, and of course Mike Brearley. Thank you very much indeed, gentlemen.